Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? Is he the one that stole your picnic basket? Or did he raid your campsite one night and have the nerve to steal all your Hershey bars? Or did you find out that you weren't the only one watching television late at night, and that the King of the Forest was watching Harry and the Hendersons ride along with you through the window? Well, if so, you need to type it up in an email and send it to me at contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com and tell me all about it. Then I'll get it narrated, and I'll put it up here and share it with everyone. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, my Sasquad. Thanks for stopping in again tonight. You know, I always love having some company. I'm just having myself a cup of black coffee tonight with a handful of simple vanilla wafer cookies. Remember those? Well, you know, sometimes the simple snacks are really the best. Whatever snack that you've got, I hope you got it ready, because we've got a lineup tonight that will keep you busy for a while. First, we have a couple of short pieces that were sent in where the people aren't too sure what the heck happened or what the heck they heard. Then, we have a snowmobile sighting, and then a few more of what the heck was that kind of encounters. So grab your snackage, saddle up, because we're getting ready to head on into Sasquatch Valley for tonight's listener-submitted encounters. Hi, Nance. I'm not 100% sure that I, and at the time my wife, may have had an encounter. I'm sorry if this isn't very exciting. My name is Walter, and you may use my name if you like. I have nothing to hide. I'm a 58-year-old Army veteran. I live in the beautiful state of West Virginia. My wife and I had rented a cabin at Blackwater Falls. There are a lot of deer around these cabins. One evening, my wife and I were sitting on the rear deck of the cabin, drinking hot coffee and just relaxing, enjoying the outdoors. I had heard a woodpecker doing his thing, and I had a little giggle about that. It was very peaceful, though. Then I felt like someone or something was watching us. You see, I have Native ancestors, so I try to be very observant of my surroundings. I asked my wife if she felt anything. She said, "I think so." At this time, I started talking into the direction of the woods, right there behind the cabin. I told whatever was watching us that we meant no harm, that we are peaceful people. I guess I'll never know why I did the next thing, but I found myself doing a Bigfoot yell, not my normal behavior. And after a couple of minutes, I heard a single wood knock. I was totally elated and overrun with pure happiness, and I felt very lucky to be given such a special gift from the Creator and the possible forest people. I still think about that moment to this day. I'm alone now. The marriage didn't work out, but at least I feel more close to the forest because of this event. Thank you for your stories, ma'am. I enjoy them very much. Happy New Year. Hello, Nance. It's me again. It's been a while since I sent in my baby Bigfoot encounter from when I was a young kid. I had something happen to me in the summer of 2020. It was nothing incredible, but it was intriguing, so I thought I would send it in. During the summer of 2020, my family went on a couple of camping trips. Camping was something that we could do to get out of the house and still stay safe from COVID-19, since it was outside and there weren't too many people around. Our first camping trip of the summer was in a national park near the famous Mount St. Helens. That's an area with quite a few Sasquatch sightings and encounters. When we arrived at our campsite, my family and I began to set up the tent and the camper. When we had set up all of our camping equipment, I decided to go and explore. There was a trail that began very close to our campsite, so I decided to go walk this trail and enjoy the sights and sounds of the forest. I had been walking for about 20 minutes or so and had gotten pretty far away from the campsite area. I usually enjoy walking in the woods, and I was enjoying it here as well, until I came across an odd spot in the forest. Everything about this area was a bit odd. There wasn't a wide variety of plants here. It was this huge field of ferns with very tall trees growing here and there. Now, as I was walking through this new part of the forest, I heard something rather odd. It was a sort of clacking sound, like someone hitting a rock against a tree. It was a lot quieter than those loud tree knocks that you always hear about, and it wasn't one click. Each time I heard this noise, it was a couple click noise, one after another, about half a second between each click. At first, I thought it was just a tree creaking in the wind. But as I was walking, a breeze blew through the trees, and I heard a creaky tree up close. The creaking of the tree sounded very different from the clicking noises I was hearing. It couldn't have been a woodpecker either. It was too loud and slow to be a woodpecker. Now, I was awfully curious about this noise, so I went off the trail to investigate. I yelled out, "Hello!" But the only response was more of this clicking sound. So I got closer. But with every single step that I took closer toward this sound, I started sweating, and I became more and more nervous, almost sick feeling. I wanted to know what it was, sure, but I had an overwhelming feeling of "get out of here now" coming from my mind. I decided if whatever this thing is making me this nervous, then I should just turn around. So I did, and I quickly walked back to my campsite. Now, was what I heard a Bigfoot? I don't know. It's a lot more likely that it was a crazy person out there in the woods. But if that was the case, turning around is something I'm glad I did. But then again, it could have been a Sasquatch. Maybe communicating by hitting two rocks together or something. A person and a Bigfoot are the two main options that I could really think of. But who knows? My fascination in Bigfoot might be clouding my judgment. I just want to add one more thing before I end this. I can't remember which video it was, but I believe in one of the stories you told on the channel, there was a story about a Sasquatch making clicking sounds to supposedly communicate while hunting. Yeah, hunting. If that really was a Bigfoot, there's a chance they didn't just want to say hello. Anyway, thanks for reading my story. I hope you found it interesting. Buckeye Bigfoot, here you go. My encounter or sighting happened in Minnesota. We were at Bearhead Lake State Park. The date was February 2, 2009. It was somewhere between 2 and 3 that afternoon. I was not wearing a watch, so I can't be certain. We were north of East Bay out on the Snowmobile Trail. We had wound through trail covered by trees on both sides, and then we came to a break in the trees on the side. To our left, there was a larger clearing. We could see 40 or 50 feet back from the trail. We had slowed to a stop so my brother could get at a large sheet of ice that was forming on his windscreen for some reason. The temperatures that day were hovering right around and just above freezing going back and forth. The snow was wet with melt, and we kept getting bogged down on our snowmobiles. He was working right then to pry or slide the wet ice sheet off of his windscreen, and he was focused on that. I was waiting, and I was looking all around and back into the clearing. It was beautiful with the white snow. But something caught my attention. At the back edge of the clearing that I could see through, I suddenly observed a tall, man-like shape. It startled me because we were so far out from anywhere. My first thought was that someone had broke down on their snowmobile and were trying to walk back, or someone had gotten lost. Then I took in the height and the heft of the shape that I observed, and I knew that was no man. It was standing there, just watching us. If it was making any sounds, I didn't hear it because of the idling snowmobiles. I yelled out to my brother, who was just ahead of me on the trail. I tapped his shoulder, too, and I pointed over at the creature to the left. He looked over, and he saw it, too. As soon as I pointed to the creature, it suddenly turned and walked along the edge of the trees of the clearing, and then it turned to its right, went deeper in the trees, and then was gone very soon. What we observed was taller than a human. I had no way to perfectly judge the height, but I am comfortable saying 8 to 8.5 feet tall at least. What I observed was dark brown, possibly almost black in color. Its arms were very long, and they swung high back and forth when it walked. It had no difficulty walking through the snow. I noticed that it picked up its whole foot from the deep snow each time it walked, like it had snowshoes on. The feet and the legs did not drag through the snow the way a human would if it was walking. It moved faster than someone with snowshoes could have moved, and at that time the snow was high calf deep when I stood in it. I did see the full legs and the feet from the side as it picked its feet up and walked. There were no snowshoes. If it was wearing any shoes at all, they were form-fitted and had fur or some other covering that was the exact same color as the rest of the covering it had on, and it was seamlessly formed. From the side, the upper thighs looked very thick and rounded. My brother tells me to add that it was a barrel-chested thing, which was only visible once it turned and was walking. When it faced us, it just looked wide. Our distance from the creature, we both think, was about 20 to 25 yards. I remember having an impression of eye contact being made when I pointed it out to my brother. But upon talking it over with my brother, neither of us recalled the eyes or any face detail at all. We both do think there was eye contact, but neither of us can say why, since we don't recall eyes. We grew up in the area, and we know all the wildlife here very well. What we observed could not be a mistaken identity for any animal in the area. I nor my brother ever felt threatened. As it was walking away, my brother said to me, "Take a good look, because we're looking at one of the rarest things in the world." Our thoughts on this is that it was just walking through, and that if we had not stopped our snowmobiles, we probably wouldn't have ever seen it. We also think it probably stopped because we stopped, as it only started walking again when I pointed at it. We have no memory of it looking back at us once it started walking away. I believe that it understood what the noise from the snowmobiles meant, and that it would know if we were pursuing it just from the noise. And we had no desire to pursue it. We did briefly discuss going back over to that area and trying to look for tracks and maybe photograph them. But we decided against that. We felt that if it saw us make any move to its previous location, that it might be seen as some form of aggression towards it, as if we were trying to pursue it. And if it was still around, we didn't want that. So we got out of the area right away. We did not report this to anyone in any position of authority. We didn't want the creature to be bothered if it's still in the area. We have been through that area again on snowmobiles and at other times of the year. We have seen no evidence of it, and we have looked. To our knowledge, there are no other sightings in that area, so we feel that it must have moved on. Well, we hope so anyway. Thanks, Signed, Millie and her brother Jackson. Hi, Nance. My name is Ray, and I love listening to you tell stories. Here are two of several that I've just recently begun to write down and share. Listening to other people share has helped me to get them off my chest, and I'm actually remembering more details. Unsolicited guests. I live in North Central Pennsylvania. I don't think many people associate Pennsylvania with Bigfoot. However, I've seen the reporting numbers going up over the last several years. So if you've had any kind of encounter in Pennsylvania, please share it with the rest of us. The first incident was 30-plus years ago. I'm 53 now, but I was about 19 or 20 at the time. Me and one of my close hunting and fishing buddies decided to do a night fish for big bass at this very large pond in northern Pennsylvania. There was no camping allowed, so we got there about 2 hours before dark, about 7 p.m. It was a beautiful, clear, warm evening in late June. We had the whole place to ourselves all evening. Well, almost. After we had taken the boat out of the back of my scout and placed it at the water's edge, we set up a propane lantern on a picnic table and then heated up some beef stew that my buddy had made earlier. We just ate and joked around for hours with a radio turned down low, just sitting in the glow of the lantern beside the pond. The pond itself was high on a mountain, surrounded by thousands of acres of forest, with the access road passing along the end where the spillway is. The dirt road continues past the end of the pond and then plunges back into the forest. When you drive up to the pond, there is a chipped parking lot and a restroom set off to one side with a few picnic tables scattered around. The pond is oblong, and looking into the woods down the left side, it's fairly open with little ground clutter, and medium-sized pines are scattered about. About midnight, I wandered over to the boat in the darkness, which was beside my truck, about 10 yards from our picnic table. I stood by the boat for a moment, looking up at the beauty of the starlit sky, unimpeded by any city lights or clouds. I had been coming up here my whole life because I loved the wilderness, and listening to all the night creatures playing their music, gazing at the stars, and fishing, of course. Knowing you're 45 miles from civilization just added to the experience. At some point, I was slowly interrupted by the thought that there was no sound. None. None of the usual frogs croaking, mosquitoes buzzing, crickets. Nothing. That was disturbing. I began to focus on one intrusive sound, which sent a chill up my spine. I was young at the time. However, I grew up next to the forest and spent all my free time playing, hunting, camping, and etc. in the woods, and I especially loved being there at night. So I had no fear of the dark, nor did my buddy. I realized that what I was hearing was the sound of very big rocks landing in the pond in deep water. I have fished there for years, and I knew where all the deep points were in the pond. Where I was hearing the splashes were toward the center of the pond. I quickly called my buddy over and I said, "Listen." After about 5 splashes, he turned to me and he just mumbled, "What could do that? Those splashes are like 30 yards from the bank." Suddenly the splashes stopped, and we went back to the picnic table, back to the light. We speculated for a few minutes about what it could be, then laughed it off. We started making plans for how we'd locate and catch the big bass that we'd come there to catch, and then we started hearing something moving in the woods from the direction along the bank nearest to the splashes, which was about 100 yards away. We turned off the radio, and we realized The forest was still dead silent. We sat still, listening for movement down along the pond where the trees were sparse. We could now tell that they were getting closer. So I grabbed my spotlight that was plugged into my cigarette lighter in the Scout. But we couldn't see anything moving. I said, maybe it's a bear that smelled the stew from earlier. Or maybe it's just deer coming in for a drink of water. The sound of footsteps were heavy and bipedal and started to spread out and multiply. I said, there's more than one, whatever they are. The longer we listened, the more we realized they were slowly moving in and creating an arc around us. We started spotlighting again, but nothing. When they seemed to be within about 10 yards, we started hearing and seeing objects being thrown in our direction. A few minutes later, those objects, pine cones, small sticks and stones, were landing at our feet. I walked over to my truck and I grabbed my shotgun, and while my buddy was anxiously spotlighting a 180-degree arc around us, I yelled, I don't know who you are or what you're doing, but that's close enough, and this isn't funny. We could now hear movement behind us, too, so I said to my buddy, this isn't right. I can hear them within 5 yards of us, and we still can't see them. I'll stand guard. You load the truck quickly. If we had to guess, there were at least 6 to 8 moving in around us, plus however many were now moving in behind us. With the truck haphazardly packed and the boat barely tied down to the truck, we took off. We drove 20 miles to where my grandparents' house was sitting empty. They had moved down to South Carolina. And we made camp in the driveway for the night. The next morning, we went fishing, but we chose somewhere else to go. For 30 years, that night has haunted me, not knowing what had really transpired or who our mystery guests were. But now I believe I know. I'm just grateful they didn't scream or growl at us being that close, or I would have soiled my drawers. Now, I've come to believe that they understand that during the day, the area belongs to the public. However, the area and the night belongs to them. And by midnight, they decided that we had worn out our welcome. In hindsight, I suspect it was a group of juvenile Sasquatch just having a good laugh at our expense, and they really weren't malevolent. A strange disappearance. About 10 years later, I was turkey hunting near where my grandmother lived. I had parked just off the edge of the main road and climbed a 10-foot-high bank onto a bench that ran parallel to the road. The bench was about 50 yards deep where it met the base of a very steep mountainside. I knew the turkeys crossed the road right by my car, so I only walk about 10 yards towards the mountain and sat down. There's a lot of very large boulders and rocks on the bench and hillside, yet with the scattered hemlocks, I could still see nearly 100 yards left and right across the bench. After several hours, I needed to get up off the root that was digging into my butt, and I needed to stretch my legs. I only walked about 20 yards toward the mountain and then leaned against a huge boulder that slanted at about a 50-degree angle. I just kind of scooted up the rock about a foot and then laid back for a bit to relax. About 15 minutes later, I could hear footsteps in the distance behind me. I guessed to be about 100 yards away. They were marching along at a steady pace. I figured it was another hunter at first, and I decided to stay still so I wouldn't startle him since I was in full camo. It seemed very odd at the time that another hunter would be near me since there were no other cars around and the closest house was a mile away. As the sound of the steps got rapidly closer, something didn't feel right. Why would a hunter be loudly tramping along through the forest at that pace if he's hunting? Where was he heading? As the sound closed to within 50 yards or so, I realized not only were the steps very loud, but I could feel the vibration through the ground and through the rock I was resting on. My mind is racing, thinking about what else could it be if it's not a man? Bigfoot did not cross my mind. It never does for some reason when I'm hunting, regardless of having several encounters and one sighting. 40 yards, 30 yards. Now I'm panicking. I thought, if this thing is dangerous, I won't see it until it literally walks right by me. I placed my trigger finger on the safety on my shotgun, and I was desperately trying to slide off the boulder onto the ground so I could swing around and see what's approaching. I hear it now within 10 yards as I swing my barrel 180 degrees. The instant I did that, the sound stopped, and there was nothing there. I quickly scanned the area. However, in my fear-induced haze, I'm not sure how well I was seeing. I decided to walk back to my original spot, mostly because it was much closer to my car. I sat down, my heart still pounding, and looked around again. Nothing was moving. It was dead silence. I thought maybe I should walk back over and look around and see if I can spot whatever it was. However, I had this irrational, unexplainable fear, and I felt that I should not go back over, but felt like that I was supposed to leave. If there's one thing I've counted on, and one thing that has served me well, it's my intuition. So I left. I know it's a bit of an anticlimactic ending. However, I've never been fearful hunting in the woods before, so I felt it was simply best to go somewhere else for the day. Otherwise, I may have ended seeing something I didn't want to, at least not that close. Thank you, Nance, for what you do and for providing the opportunity to share our stories. I don't think that we need to necessarily fear the woods. However, it's important to know you're not alone out there and to be aware of your intuition at all times. Sincerely, Ray. All right, my Sasquad, that's it. That's tonight's lineup. I sure hope you've enjoyed them. And I want to tell you, the story from Finn, I will put a link in the video description below if you want to go back and listen to his encounter about the baby Bigfoot. That was pretty interesting. I also just want to take a moment to remind everyone that Cam Buckner from Dixie Cryptid and myself will be sharing a booth at the Gatlinburg Bigfoot Convention this summer. Now, the convention is for one day only, July 24th, so if you haven't already gotten your tickets, I suggest you do so soon. From everything I've heard and read, well, they sell out pretty quick. I'm not familiar with the one in Gatlinburg, but I know the one here in Ohio, it sells out within a day or two. It's insane. So go ahead and get your tickets, because me and Cam, we'd love to have you stop by and say hello. Otherwise, someone asked me again about the stainless steel mugs, where to get them. I don't sell on the YouTube page per se like most people. There's not that merchandise shelf there, only because Teespring doesn't offer the things I like. I prefer the stainless steel mugs. So if you are interested in getting yourself a stainless steel mug, look right up there. Isn't that pretty? I'll put the link to buy them in the description below. Buckeye Bigfoot is in no way guaranteeing that this mug is strong enough to use as a weapon against a Sasquatch. Buckeye Bigfoot is in no way responsible for any injuries that may result from a Sasquatch desiring to take the shiny mug away from you. All right. Well, with those disclaimers out of the way, I just want to thank you all again for taking the time to stop in and visit for a while. And while tonight has come to an end, you know we'll be meeting up again real soon. And until we do, I need you to always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone. Whoa, 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 whoa. Where do you think you're going without hitting that subscribe button? That's right. You need to hit that button. Don't make me turn a Sasquatch loose on you. All right. Hit that subscribe button and everything will be all right.